I'm so delighted, very delighted, to welcome Jenny Watson to the stage, an artist who I'm sure many of you are familiar with. If you would like to get more familiar with Jenny's work, she has an incredible installation right now on in the Embodied Knowledge exhibition, which is over in the QAG buildings, and it is an impressive, engaging, wonderful work that I know you will gain much by standing there and taking it all in. And I just wanted to, for those of you who don't know Jenny, tell you a little bit about her biography. She is a really leading Australian artist whose conceptual painting practice spans more than four decades. And inspired by both punk and feminism, her readily recognizable sort of autobiographical and fictional works combine color, fabric, text, recurring figures, and subtle humor to create a very powerful narrative. And I think that diversity of her materials is a really compelling aspect of her practice, and we'll talk about that soon. Also, the relationship between text and image that's central to her work. And this frequently includes a small panel of hand-painted text that sits alongside a larger image, undercutting or changing its meaning. And what's also remarkable about Jenny is her very international profile. And I think she's traveled. Some of the conversations we've had have been around travel, world travel. I think, Jenny, you're a world traveler. And, you know, the idea of that you use a lot of the textiles you collect while on your travels with, you know, in your paintings, things like that. And, you know, a diverse range of self-portraits. We may as well put an image up right away. your alter egos, your cast of long-haired women, horses, ballerinas, rock guitarists, cats, horses especially, and the idea of focusing on those lives as well. And also, the thing I was commenting on is I think I have a very partial list here of where Jenny's work is included. Major state and regional galleries in Australia, a number of overseas collections, including in Japan. I won't read the list. It's really long. illustrious list, so in Europe, in Japan, you know, all through Australia. So welcome, Jenny. It's wonderful to have you here.
Thank you.
Let's welcome Jenny. Yeah. and I think, you know, given the topic of the lecture we just listened to, I think I wanted to start out with this idea of hearing you maybe reflect on the idea of autobiography in art and how that is part of your practice. And certainly, you know, this work, which is, you know, absolutely includes figures that are visibly you and as I said, those alter egos. So does autobiography matter here, and how does it matter?
Yeah, well, I trained in the early 70s at the National Gallery School in Melbourne. And at that time, the main influences were large colour field painting, mainly from New York, and the beginnings of conceptual art, which was happening in New York, London and Europe. And I remember thinking as a 20-year-old from Box Hill, which is a very bleak suburb in Melbourne, how do I fit into this? How does that work for me? And so I just started painting the things that were relevant to my very simple life. Suburban houses, pets, horses. I had been a rider, still am a rider. Music, boys. I just thought, why can't I make that the subject of my work? Later on, when I was not a 20-year-old, it was more of a conceptual idea of, okay, well, this conceptual art is very academic and it looks very black and white and it looks very radical. Why can't these same interests of mine be filtered through that? So I started using text, but the text was not a conceptual order about the future of art. it was maybe about breaking up with a boyfriend or something. So it was a real attempt to bring reality, as I saw it, reality of being a 60s teenager and a young woman in the 70s, into a conceptual art framework. So I always call my work conceptual painting because although it's painting and I was trained as a painter and I trained very young as a painter because my parents sent me to oil painting classes when I was 12, it's still, my work could not have evolved without the happening of conceptual art. Mm. So I look at Kassouz, Victor Bergen, a lot of the feminists of the time, the writings of Lucy Lippard. Yeah, it's painting, but it definitely is painting that has to acknowledge that it's being done in the time we live in.
Wonderful. And, I mean, it's interesting to hear you talk about how that autobiographical element wasn't readily accepted, and that fusion you're talking about with conceptual art is absolutely fascinating. I'm just wondering, like, in the early days of your practice, Do you think there was a resistance, like a critical resistance to how you were approaching things? Or and I suppose it didn't really matter, did it? Because you knew what you wanted to do.
there was a kind tolerance at the gallery school.
Yeah.
I cannot say that people like Alan Leach Jones or Mark Clark or William Kelly acted as though I couldn't possibly use the imagery I was experimenting with.
Mm.
But it was a sort of tolerance. You know, it was like, that's not really the way we make serious art.
Right.
And then as time went on, you know, things changed and more people started to experiment. There was certainly a lot more women wanting to make art about their reality. The trip to Australia by Lucy Lippard in the early 70s was very important for changing people's thinking.
Mm.
And when I made my first trip to New York in 75, Lucy very generously introduced me to her circle. So
wow.
I met the major women artists of the day, some of whom are still alive. So, it was pretty interesting to put that very personal autobiographical imagery into the current art context.
Yeah. And just thinking sort of a little more specifically around, you know, reflections on the self and you know, because I was thinking that through even in terms of how I was, the works I chose to represent a particular topic, and thinking through the idea of a reflection on the self, putting the self out there is I think, in some ways a brave and ambitious, I do, because I think so often the idea is, you know, object, and that comes through in the conceptual art that you were talking
maybe
about.
Maybe we could scroll through a few more, which might explain what I'm talking about a little bit more. But it was a philosophical question that I guess I'm still asking myself: can the life of a suburban girl without any huge privileges, then as an art student, then as a young woman artist, then as a more mature woman artist, then as a very well-travelled woman artist, can that imagery be the subject of a serious art practice?
Mm.
Yeah, it's a philosophical question. And I answer that through my highly personal images.
There's a transition to hand here as well, isn't there,
yeah,
Jenny?
Yeah, well, this painting's 1974.
Yeah.
And in 1974, I was teaching high school full-time, so it was very hard to get the time to paint a show, but I did paint a show of all life-size paintings of racehorses. So when you walked into Powell Street Gallery in Melbourne, you saw 8 life-size horses. It was like walking into a stable. And, you know, conceptually it would still stand up. It was a good idea for a show. And then these are more expressive works from later on. This one on the left from the current show, and this one a little bit earlier. Yeah, that one is one of my self-humour play on words. It's called balletomane. As we know, a balletomane is someone who knows a lot about ballet, but I've put the ballet tutu over the horse's mane. It's crazy, but it's been very popular. I saw one in Japan, and it's been around quite a bit.
It's interesting, too, when we think of autobiography and, like, a changing self, because obviously we change as we get older. And, I mean, some artists I've talked to sort of are not comfortable or even happy to look at their earlier, you know, and I wonder about that with your practice. I mean, is there, or that sense of revision and inclusion of previous...
Look, I think I was lucky in that, because I always used imagery. Whether you're developing imagery in a highly realistic way or whether it's exploding and becoming much more organic, you're not in an area where you have to say, oh, I reject that lot of work. You know, I spent 5 years on work that I don't really own now. I think with figuration it is all sort of pulled together.
Yeah.
And I had the greatest, most privileged learning experience when we hung my show at the MCA in Sydney, The Fabric of Fantasy, which was around 120 works. The work had gone to the gallery and I was on the plane going down to hang it, and I remember thinking, oh, I'll have to pull some out, you know, it couldn't possibly all be okay. And yet I walked into the gallery and it was all around the walls and it was all okay.
Of course.
It was a surprise, but yeah.
And that's absolutely why you should all go and see this, because how many are there, Jenny, in this?
There are 48 in
there's
that
48
piece.
In this installation, yeah. And you can sort of linger and walk through each and every one and think through the different stories that are sort of being... And so I actually really wanted to ask you also about this idea of, like, recurrence or recurrent motifs and... Mm. I mean, something I talked about a bit earlier was the idea of dreams and the subconsciousness and things that just haunt us and we can't let go of. And is that something that you see as part of your practice, or is it...
Do we have any more?
This is the main one, I know. So, everyone has to go and look for themselves too. Yeah.
Or just Google my name and you can see a lot. But, I think with imagery, I mean, if you look back through my entire... Earth, it's a limited amount of imagery. You know, it's to do with the house, the horse, dogs and cats, myself, bands, you know, all my interests. Text became a very important part of imagery, whether I exploded the letters so that they became quite abstract or whether it was a very readable piece of text. But I've actually just kept going through those imagery and those concerns over and over again, but in different forms. Mm. And sometimes the form was to try and do something fairly radical within the history of painting, where I started using dress fabrics and furnishing fabrics. And that was a light bulb moment, because I noticed that the old-fashioned Hessian horse feed sacks were not unlike Belgian linen. And Hessian horse feed sacks cost nothing. Belgian linen is very expensive.
Mm.
So I thought, why can't I prime this horse feed sack and make a painting? And I did. And that was a light bulb moment. I then realised that not only did painting have to not have a perfectly primed stretch canvas, but that apart from the horse feed sack, I could use any fabric in the world that existed. And I've done that on my travels. I've just bought fabrics in every place I've been, whether it's a thin chiffon that I might use two or three layers of, or a beautiful Indian cotton that tends to have a particular colour range because it's in India. The fabrics became a very important part of, and probably the question I always asked about, you know, can I make art out of this? I'm continually asking what is a painting? Yeah. You know, is it a piece of fabric pinned up with drawing pins with a little animal on a shelf next to it, not live animal, toy? what is a painting? You know, does it have to be stretched canvas? I think artists have answered those questions in really interesting ways in the last 50 years.
Yeah.
And strangely enough, well, people think it's strange, but one of my favourite artists is Jackson Pollock, because his modus operandi of painting was, it was quite like dancing. Mm-hmm. You know, the canvas was on the floor and he threw the paint, he threw it in skeins. And this energy was very connected with an alcoholic energy, which was part of his life. He had huge amounts of time where he didn't paint, and then when he was feeling good and not drinking, he was painting. But I find that a really interesting approach to painting. And, you know, if I had to list my favourite artists, which I won't, but they have a very interesting approach to painting. It just doesn't accept, you know, the code.
It's sort of pushing the boundaries of materiality thinking.
Exactly.
And your use of textiles, I mean, that's fascinating. Yeah. Is there textile, like, talk us through this series.
Well,
I mean,
these ones, are they're painted in acrylic on a double page of a catalogue. They were the proofs that the designer used to get the colour right of earlier works in the catalogue. So I'm actually painting on a double page of a history of my own work, which I wasn't sure would work.
Yeah,
I wasn't sure it would work, but it did. And it's made a set of work that I love and has been incredibly popular with people walking through. And
I think that's really true. So I walked through with my family and there was... through the whole embodied knowledge exhibition, and without saying to them, oh, this is, you know, because they've met Jenny before, but I didn't say that. So it was only the first, but they immediately gravitated to this work, which I thought was really interesting. And so my husband, my children, for example, they were just, oh, what's the story here? What's the story here? And that's, I think that's that kind of querying and that the maybe the idea of an unsettled piece that... we're constantly going back to with more and more questions and the seriality of it. So something, you know, I've been mentioning a few different exhibitions today, but something this also brought to mind for me was, if you'll remember the Gerhard Richter exhibition that happened when there was the Builder Atlas, this kind of atlas of memories that he pulled together that was sort of stretched along like the kind of the spine of the exhibition is what they call it. And to me, it's not to say, you know, the methods are different, but there's this sort of idea of memory and memory making and recurrence happening here that I think is really compelling. So absolutely wonderful to see it. I wondered if, I mean, thinking about just going back to this and thinking about that movement, like looking at the previous work and then thinking through the very different approaches here. I mean, that's a way of thinking of biography as well, like just your shift in terms of the materiality and your exploration of new forms of materiality as manifest here. Yeah. And I guess I also have a question about like the future and the way you see yourself positioning yourself having done this very evocative work. Is there something new in terms of materiality you're thinking through or wishing to probe?
Probably the main thing with the work over at QAG at the moment is I didn't know if I could paint over imagery that already existed.
Yeah.
So, for example, looking at this one, there's quite a strong image of a little girl in a blindfold, which is an image I've used quite a bit. Whether that would take another image and whether it would look okay or whether it would just become a jumble, that was something I didn't know before I started. Mm. But as it happened, the reproduced images of earlier work were small enough that they provided a background that, you know, it was perfectly okay.
Mm.
Yeah.
And was there an intentional element around the specific text selected? Like, is the text in dialogue with the image there at all, or is it more reflective as, you know, that
no,
was
not
the catalog?
Really. I mean, if we go back to the slide of the whole lot, there's certainly some text pieces, but they, I mean, in the top middle one where the girl's holding a phone, that block of text there is from the catalogue.
Yeah.
So that's some artistry that was already in the catalogue. Yeah. That wasn't painted on.
Yeah.
No. So there's no new text on these works.
Yeah.
It's just the image over the page that exists, and just really interesting seeing how that works. For example, there's a lot of red. I mean, what's really interesting about seeing work in a big exhibition is that you actually see what you've done.
Mm.
In the studio, that's quite difficult because you're very involved with the work and you're focused on the one piece, and you might even have other considerations like when it has to go to Melbourne or Sydney. So you actually don't see it as clearly as when you walk into a gallery like anyone else walking into a gallery.
Yeah.
And one thing I noticed with this work is that I use quite a lot of red. And if people ask me to describe my work, I'd say, oh, you know, it's moody and it's about horses and that means there's a lot of black and brown. But it's actually quite brightly exuberant.
Yeah.
But I don't see that when I'm doing it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I feel like red has a history of like kind of being an unwieldy, like a difficult color to tame. Or that's how if I think of, you know, works in the history of art that are sort of drenched in red, it's like a hemorrhaging, you know. So it, I think it's a challenge. It is very evident there.
And, yeah.
But everything from a balloon to, you know what I mean? It is present there.
One thing about using a fabric that already exists in its own right is that, you know, I've done quite a lot of works on red velvet, and it's Chinese red velvet. So it's that real red, you see, you know, when you see things about China. So in a way, your so-called background exists. And that's quite when you think about it, that's quite a step forward because I teach. And when I teach, students often don't realise or don't take into consideration that the so-called background is probably 5/6 of the piece of work they're dealing with. So they're fixated on an image, painting their image, and then they'll actually say, what will I do for the background? that is something that's quite... it has to be a solid foundation, and by using fabrics that already supplied a so-called background, you get a very stark use of an image. Mm. You know, I've used I bought some fabrics in Kuala Lumpur, which were when the women go out at night and they're not wearing the black chador, which is now such a controversial object in our society. They have a head wrapping that's most beautiful printed chiffon with sequins sewn on it. Mm. So you might have a floral fabric in blue, and then you might have an image of a bird sewn on in sequins. And that's their night gear. That's when they're allowed to dress up more.
Mm.
And, if I stretch something like that, then I've got a very beautiful foundation to then decide, you know, what do I want to paint on it?
Mm.